Hi, it's Dwyer, gamblersadvisory.com, DwyerVIP.com. Look us up in the sports section on Roku. We're there. Dwyer Boxing and Sports News. The vanity code to add it on the Roku page is Dwyer Boxing News, one word. Same thing with iTunes. Also, note that I have a pay channel here where I make predictions on some sporting events on YouTube. The catchphrase is Dwyer Sports Betting. Remember, the opinion you should follow should be your own. Just consider this video to be a second opinion from a complete stranger online. Now, this weekend I watched a lot of fights. Tony Bellew against Nathan Cleverley. The Lomachenko fight. The Manny Pacquiao, Chris Algieri fight. The Anthony Joshua fight. Watched a few fights. But to me, the scariest fight I watched, the one with the highest talent level, the one that leapt out at me, and this is one man's opinion. I don't want anyone to think that I'm anything other than another person here giving you one take. Okay? Don't view me as some authoritative voice. Just view me as a friend here online. By far the scariest fight I saw was James DeGale's deconstruction of Marco Antonio Perriman. Right now, longtime viewers here online know that I've been tracking DeGale for years. Right? For some time. I've been riding the DeGale coattails for a long time. I believe this guy is special. Right? As I see it now, I become more and more convinced with time that there are only two other guys in the sport who might be on his level. Now, I know I'm sounding like a crackpot. Let the chips fall where they may. But I believe DeGale is one of the top three in the sport pound for pound. The other two gentlemen, as I see it, are Floyd Mayweather and Andre Ward. Right? Let me point out, though, that DeGale stands alone in that he doesn't have a title, right? He's not a world champion. He's Carl Froch's mandatory, right? So I don't believe casual fans know who he is, even though DeGale has won an Olympic gold medal, right? I believe that DeGale is one of those open secrets in sports where you see the guy and you understand this is a different level. This guy has skills that, quite frankly, few have, right? He's not a great athlete. I don't look at DeGale and think that he's, let's say, the athlete that I believe Alexander Povetkin is, right? That I believe Vladimir Klitschko is, right? There's certain guys in the game who you could imagine participating in a decathlon and dominating the field, right? DeGale doesn't remind me of prime Roy Jones. He doesn't have lightning quick reflexes, right? He's not a freak athlete. What he is a freak technician, right? He's better than many of the highly touted fighters out there. I watched the Lomachenko fight. Now keep in mind, I picked Lomachenko over Russell. I'm not bad-mouthing guys who I have anything against. I'm just here giving you one man's opinion. Right? As I watched Lomachenko in his last fight, as I watched him in the Orlando Salido fight, right? I was a little bit startled that Lomachenko doesn't have that extra pop on his punch. He can dominate you. He can overwhelm you. But yet opponents are still standing. And Lomachenko has to spend a lot of energy. He's kind of darting in and out of the pocket. A lot of lateral movement. Great combinations. Incredible accuracy. He's certainly one of the best fighters in the sport. I don't care how many pro fights he has. Right? But he doesn't have that pop where when he has you outclassed, he closes the show. Right? The Gael has that pop. Right? I would argue, too, that Lomachenko has to work harder than the Gael. Because Lomachenko's in the pocket, then he moves to the side, then he moves to the side. The Gael can literally set up shop in the pocket. Regardless of the style of the fighter he's fighting. Let me point out another big-time puncher. Gennady Golovkin. Right? You know, contrary to popular opinion, I've tracked Golovkin for years. I love Golovkin. I think he's earned what he has. Right? I like the fact that Golovkin can throw big punches from odd angles. Right? The Gael can too. There's a difference between the two. Understand that Golovkin throws punches from odd angles. That's his style. He doesn't have a switch where suddenly he's only throwing straight punches if the situation calls for it. The Gael does. Understand, the Gael is a guy who can fight you without a loop or with a loop. Understand, the Gael's loop isn't because that's the way he throws the punch. It's because that's the way the punch will land in that fight. Right? So, I haven't seen this level of, you know, ability to adjust, to change angles. Perhaps ever. Right? Other guys do certain things better than the Gael. The Gael's jab, let's face it, is underdeveloped. Right? The Gael's game is a bit unorthodox. You see him fighting out of a southpaw stance, and you ask yourself, is he really a southpaw? It's unclear. Right? The Gael also suffers from the same thing Floyd Mayweather suffers from. There's some part of his personality that's unlikable. So, I believe the Gael beats George Groves. Right? Then, of course, doesn't on the judges' scorecards. I understand the fight was close. I would argue the Gael's toughest fight was against Wolchewski. Some fighter way back when. That's a close fight. Right? That's a very close fight. I thought that fight's closer than the George Groves fight. Right? Let me say this too. The best boxing analysis, I heard this last weekend, by far, the best boxing analysis, is after George Groves had all kinds of problems in his fight. They asked Carl Froch, who was, you know, part of the telecast, what the matter was with Groves. What was Groves doing wrong? And Froch's response was, you know, I think he's been cobra'd. Right? You know, Groves was so knocked out by Carl Froch. It's going to be a while before he gets back to where he was. I'm not sure if he ever gets there. I don't think a De Gale George Groves fight is remotely close today. Right? I don't think George Groves is ready to deal with De Gale, and I'm not sure if Groves would be able to move as well as he did that night. Well, be that as it may, understand that De Gale can close the show unlike Lomachenko. The Gael can straighten his punches, unlike Gennady Golovkin. The Gael can switch from southpaw to orthodox, and he somehow pulls his defense together. And keep in mind, this isn't a switch like, let's say, old Andre Durell would switch, where he's dancing around, and one minute he's southpaw, the next minute he's right-handed. No, this is a switch of hands from inside the pocket. And what makes the Gale really interesting is he's able to hit with power with both hands. This is while he's outboxing you. Right? I encourage everyone to look at the Marco Antonio Parabin fight. I know Carl Froch dissed Parabin on the telecast. Understand, Parabin went the distance with Bika. That was a photo finish fight. Understand, Parabin was able to use movement against Bika. He's circling Bika. Bika couldn't catch up with him. Right? Understand, Parabin is tall. Understand, Parabin has a pretty good jab. Parabin, a lot of the times, is hard to hit. Understand, it was Parabin who put Jillian Love down. Right? Love gets off the canvas. That decision's a photo finish decision. Right? The guy who got knocked down got the decision there. Right? Parabin's a world-class fighter. He easily could have been awarded the fight against Bika in a title fight. Now here he is against James DeGale. DeGale decides he's going to go on his front foot. Right? DeGale comes inside. I'm here to tell you, I have never seen Parabin hit as easily as he was hit by James DeGale. Right? And the reason it looks like Parabin is getting hit with flush punches is because of DeGale's gift, and it is a gift. He comes in, most fighters throw punches at certain angles. You know Manny Pacquiao's left hand is straight, right? As I've said in too many videos here online, right? You know certain guys throw hooks certain ways. Floyd Mayweather's, you know, left hook, you know, it's either going to hit you in the head or it's going to hit you in the body, but it's coming in at a certain angle, right? James DeGale against Parabin is playing with that very angle while maintaining his defense. Right? He's a guy who trusts his boxing skills to the point where he's in there changing the trajectory of punches while being able to protect himself while he's on his front foot. Right? I know it looks awkward. I know he's not the best athlete, right? Wow. Is this guy a technician? You know, Parabin had never been stopped in a fight. He stopped early here. What I want you to do is to revisit the last round of this short fight. It's not the punch that ends the fight. It's the left hand that hurts Parabin before the punch that ends the fight. DeGale's fooling around with angles to the point where Parabin has no clue where DeGale's next punch is going to come from. None. He gets hit flush. He gets taken out. Right? I mean, it's crazy stuff. Now, I thought the stoppage was premature. Parabin gets to his feet. The way the camera angle was, you couldn't see Parabin's eyes. I don't know whether the ref looked at Parabin and only saw the whites of his eyes. I really don't know. I'll agree Parabin didn't really complain much about the stoppage. But wow. You know, I thought this was boxing. I thought you had a chance to get off the canvas to continue fighting. Right? I thought you had up to 10 seconds on a count. Parabin's not even cut. Right? Parabin gets hit flush, no question about it. It's a couple of flush left hands. No question about it, he goes down. I thought the fight should have continued. But what's significant is that the great fighters find a way somehow to hit you with flush punches. Right? Look at DeGale, literally walk in on a tall guy with a jab, right, who's been 12 rounds with Sakio Bika, right, and look at DeGale not get hit with anything, and then throw punches from different angles, right? You know, DeGale has a bit of Marcus Maidana in him, but just imagine if Maidana, rather than just throwing punches at weird angles, could actually control the angles. And keep in mind, when you're throwing weird punches at weird angles, it's hard to maintain leverage unless this is something you've incorporated in your game over several years. Right? So, put me among those who believes. And I've said this for months, that Carl Froch is not going to fight James DeGale. They can give you every reason in the book. DeGale's not known, blah, 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 right? Think about it. An Olympic gold medalist who's not known in a savvy boxing country like the United Kingdom, right? Wasn't the DeGale-George Groves fight front page news? Wasn't that fight a sellout? And we're still hearing that DeGale's not known? Come on. Give us a break. People don't think that a fight between the reigning champion, Carl Froch, and a former Olympic gold medalist who has earned mandatory contender status is not going to be a big sellout? You got to be kidding. When you think of George Groves, don't you think of two names, Froch and DeGale? Right? So, to me, I'll just say this. I think Carl Froch is not going to fight James DeGale for one simple reason. He loses badly. You just saw a guy with a jab. Right? You just saw a guy with some boxing skills deconstructed early. I would encourage people to look at the angles in which DeGale throws punches against Brandon Gonzalez. Understand, Gonzalez's trainer is Virgil Hunter, one of the best in the business. Andre Ward's trainer. Right? The Ward people are intimately aware of James DeGale because DeGale dismantled Brandon Gonzalez. Dismantled him. Right? Carl Froch, and I don't blame him, by the way, because boxing is a lot about legacy. Right? And Carl Froch has fought the tough fights and has earned the status he has as one of the UK's best fighters. Right? If I'm Carl Froch, I can't blame a champion who has been to the top of the mountain and who then says to himself, you know what? I only have one or two more fights left. I want to fight in Las Vegas. Let me go have a high-profile fight where I have a chance. Right? You know, Carl Froch understands that he's really the UK's most exalted fighter at 168 pounds post-Calzaghe. Right? There's no harm in Froch deciding, you know what? Let me just cash out my chips, have a big fight against Chavez Jr., right? Maybe have a farewell fight against Mikael Kessler, with whom Froch has a history, right? Two fights already. Box office success, both fights. And let me bow out. So then DeGale can take UK boxing to the next chapter at 168 pounds. Right? What Carl Froch doesn't want is to pass the torch to DeGale in the ring, which might happen. DeGale is that scary. You know, one of the fights I'd love to see style-wise, because I'm not sure how it plays out, it'd be the ultimate test of DeGale, would be DeGale against Sergei Kovalev. Understand, Kovalev went to the UK destroyed. Let's face it, he destroyed Nathan Cleverley. Right? He just beat Bernard Hopkins. I'm curious to see what happens if DeGale, who likes to operate from the pocket, is in with one of the sport's hardest punchers pound for pound, right? And actually has to deal with all the heavy hooks as well as the big stamina. Let's face it, Kovalev went from unknown in the later rounds to looking like a master in the later rounds. Wasn't Hopkins' worst round in that fight, the 12th round, where he almost gets decked? It'd be interesting to see DeGale handle someone like that. But that's the only fight that interests me with DeGale at 175, because I personally don't believe Adonis Stevenson's even competitive with James DeGale at 175 pounds. I don't. Right? I think James DeGale has a talent level. Let me say, I believe the same thing of Andre Ward. I believe both of these guys have the talent level, if they wanted to run roughshod through the 175-pound ranks. The only question for me with regard to both of them is Kovalev, who's on the rise. Right? But make no mistake, what DeGale is doing is high level. I would say it's higher level than Lomachenko. It's higher level than, you know, Gennady Golovkin. I believe it's higher level than Carl Froch. I don't believe a George Groves fight at this point would even be competitive. Right? And I'm not alone in that assessment. Carl Froch doesn't believe a fight between DeGale and George Groves at this point would be competitive. Right? So, if you want to know who the best fighter is in boxing right now without a title, take a look at James DeGale. Right? Let me just say, Carl Froch has a reputation of being a guy who takes on all comers. Carl Froch has fought the tough fights. I don't think I've ever seen Carl this hesitant to fight a guy ever. And he has reason to be. Let me hear from you. Leave your comments for me here online. Visit us at gamblersadvisory.com. Thanks for stopping by.